Chapter 4. Helpful Hints. It seems fairly easy speaking in front of a mirror, doesn't it? But you're still probably concerned about the real thing, speaking in public. Let's see if we can alleviate some of your worries by helping you solve several common problems, beginning with the biggest, stage fright. Stage fright shows up in many forms. For example, you may experience some of the following: sweaty palms, dry mouth, upset stomach, shaky knees, increased heart rate, lightheadedness, nausea, an uncontrollable urge to leave the premises. The physical symptoms you may experience come from the emotional fear that you will get up and fail in front of others. This fear can be very great and very real. After all, there are a lot of stress-related what-ifs being tossed around in your mind. What will people think of me? What if they don't like me? What if I forget what I want to say? What if I'm boring? What if I sound foolish or stupid? Even worse, what if I look foolish or stupid? What if they mock me or rebut what I have to say? In short, we fear that in the brief amount of time in which we stand before other people, we will be captured in the eyes of the audience on a blooper reel that will last forever. It all may seem incredibly scary, but stage fright can be overcome. First, acknowledge your symptoms. Dry your hands. Take a drink for your dry mouth. Then, sit in a comfortable position and focus on your breathing. Use relaxation exercises to slow a racing head. Remember, you tense the muscles and then relax them. The key is not to buy into the physical symptoms and allow them to take over. Remind yourself that these symptoms aren't going to stop you from getting up and speaking. They are not going to defeat you. Ideas for combating stage fright. Here are some proven ways to do it. Number one, be very well prepared and be positively prepared. That means not just knowing your subject matter, but having a positive attitude about your topic. You've got something to say and you really want to share it. Plan for a non-stressful, relaxing period before you speak. You might even develop a simple pre-speaking routine for yourself, as many performers do. Number three, rehearse several times in conditions that simulate what you will experience while you speak, with distractions, in front of other people, and so on and so forth. Number four, if possible, visit the place where you will be speaking. Walk onto the stage, sit in one of the seats, and see the stage from the audience's perspective. Get comfortable in the setting. Number five, take a few minutes before you speak to be in a quiet place. Whether it's the green room or the restroom, find a place to do some breathing exercises, visualization, and quiet thinking about your topic. Number six, watch the audience beforehand. You might even want to mingle a little bit as they come in and get to know a few people. If you do, chances are they will be among your biggest supporters. Start liking your audience, and chances are they'll like you. Number seven, remember, you don't have to be perfect. In fact, tell yourself you will not be perfect. If you make a mistake or something goes wrong, make a joke about it. Go with the proverbial flow and use humor as a tension breaker. Number eight, avoid stimulants, such as coffee or soda with caffeine. Likewise, tranquilizers will give you more than a southern drawl, and alcohol may cause you to give a performance that you may not remember in the morning and may not want to. Number nine, stay in the present. Forget about the piano recital 32 years ago that didn't go well. You're older now and more experienced. That was in the past. Number 10. Remember, 90% or more of the people in the audience would be just as nervous as you and would do no better or worse if they traded places with you. Many speakers and performers put their nervousness to work for them. This means taking that nervous energy and using it to carry you through the presentation, starting your speech or presentation. It's time for the real deal. You walk up to the podium or microphone and you're still nervous. It's time to speak, but nothing is coming out of your mouth. What can you do? Look around for a friendly or familiar face. If there's a podium or place to put your notes, water, glass, or anything else you need, arrange those items. Take a sip of water to make sure your mouth isn't dry. Make a joke about being nervous. Stall for a moment by adjusting the microphone slightly, even if it doesn't really need to be adjusted. Imagine that you are speaking to one person. One stand-up comic used to name his audience George, and imagine he was just having a conversation with George. Oops, can we start over? Since one of the biggest fears is that you screw up, why not prepare for the occasional foul-up? A wrong word or slight flub will probably not even be noticed, so you can just keep on going. Larger flubs will require some attention. Johnny Carson, the king of late-night talk shows, would have his writers intentionally prepare lines called savers that he could use during his monologue when a joke fell flat. The larger the mistake, the more you need to acknowledge it. Immediately tell yourself, "Oops, I messed up. It happens to everyone." You might step back from the podium or microphone for a second and regain your composure. If you're holding the microphone, you might lower it a little bit and take a deep breath, then continue with something like, "As I was trying to say," or "Let's try that again." Unless something goes so seriously wrong that you need to stop speaking and call for assistance, you can usually laugh it off or make a joke about it. Sometimes an action will break the tension. Note, however, that if something draws the audience's attention away from you, such as a waiter dropping a tray of drinks at a dinner party, then you need to stop, make a comment, and essentially meet the audience at the point of their attention, in this case, the dropped tray, and bring their attention back to you. The importance of first impressions. It's a common belief that the first impression you make is critical, and it's true that in the first few seconds, even before you open your mouth, your audience will form an opinion of you, for better or worse, fairly or unfairly. People rush to judgment. The reality, however, is that first impressions are somewhat overrated. Many marvelous presentations have started off slowly and ended with a bang. Nonetheless, it's nice to get off to a good start. If for no other reason, it does help you relax. Ways to make a better first impression. Calm your nerves by visualizing yourself walking out or getting up to speak shortly before it's your turn. Take a quick look in the mirror to make sure your hair, makeup, and clothing are as ready to go as you are. Arrive early enough to scope out the room and the audience, and then make an opening comment about something current regarding the group you are speaking to, or perhaps about the room where you are speaking. Walk in with pride and confidence. Keep your shoulders straight. Look at the audience. Smile. Take a slow, cleansing breath as you approach the podium or microphone. Make eye contact from the start. Welcome your audience. Remember to set yourself up in a positive manner from the start. Keep your feet apart and your head straight, but not too stiff. If the situation calls for it, the appropriate opening joke or a unique entrance can help ease the tension and make the audience smile. Memory tips. How do actors remember all of the lines of an entire three-act play or movie? They learn it scene by scene. You can do something similar. Break your material down into little sections or chunks and get to know the key points of each section. Remember, unless you're reciting Shakespeare, in most situations you don't need to memorize your material word for word. No one will know if you go off track, as long as you remember your next important point and get back on track soon. Number 1. Break your material up into manageable parts. Look for changes in your subject matter or logical points to break it up. Mark each segment or maybe even highlight it. Number 2. Associate key words or phrases with chunks of material. Number 3. You may also insert stories, anecdotes, or jokes accordingly. Number 4. Practice several times using your cards and keywords. In time, you won't even need them, but you'll still likely keep them around as a form of reassurance. Number 5. If you find yourself going so far off on a tangent that you need to call AAA to get back on the road, go for your notes. You may want to stall for time as you find your place. Number 6. Remember to make sure your notes are in the proper sequence. Number 7. It's always acceptable and quite common to take out material to read if you are specifically quoting from another source. Use any memory prompts that you feel can help you. Just try to make your presentation flow smoothly, whether reading or from memory. Making friends with the microphone. The bigger the room, the greater the need for a mic. The modern microphone may be cordless, but it still needs to be handled with care. Feedback does not enhance a presentation. Follow these tips to make sure you get on a friendly basis with your microphone. Always make sure the microphone is turned on. The switch is usually on the side near the mouthpiece. Adjust a standing microphone to your height. Hint, put one foot on the base as you adjust it. You should hold the microphone 6 to 10 inches away from your mouth. If possible, do a sound check before the audience arrives. If you take the microphone out of the stand does not need to be there. Move it to one side. If you're holding the microphone, try to keep your arm straight with the elbow down. Clip-on microphones should be fastened to your clothing and then ignored. The same goes for the type of microphone that hangs around your neck. Be careful not to fidget with your clothes or any object near the microphone. It may pick up the sounds. When seated, remember to keep your head straight. The microphone will still pick you up. The most common microphone mistakes. Number 1. Looking as though you're going to eat the microphone. you don't need to hold it extremely close to your mouth to be clearly understood. Number two, not believing the microphone is working when it really is. Don't ever tap on it. Number three, gesturing with the mic in hand. No one will be able to hear you if the mic's 3 feet away from your mouth. Number four, believing a microphone is overly powerful. It usually won't pick up questions from the audience. Number five, not adjusting the mic properly. Position it so that you don't have to stretch or bend to reach it. Number six, being afraid of the mic. Don't stand so far away from it that it won't even pick up your voice properly. Seven, forgetting the microphone is on. Be careful what you say. Dressing for success. From the red carpet outside an award ceremony to the hallway leading into the boardroom, people are looking at what you wear and how you look. Therefore, a neat, clean, well-groomed appearance is to your advantage, unless you're fronting a punk rock band. Tips for dressing. Unless the occasion calls for it, don't wear clothes that are louder than your speech. Coordinate so that you don't blend into the background. Don't wear anything that can jingle. Don't wear something for the very first time on the day of your presentation. If you want to wear a new outfit, try it on and wear it for a while in advance. You want to feel comfortable. Wear comfortable shoes. Women, if a woman is going to be seated on stage, be conscious of the length of your skirt. Guy, remember to wear a tie clip if you're going to take off your jacket. Don't wear anything you might be prone to fidget with. Also, empty your pockets before hitting the stage. 2 pounds of change in your pockets can be very distracting. Most of the time, you will want to dress a notch above the audience. Therefore, if the audience is wearing sport jackets or blazers, you might want to go for a suit. If they're dressed casually, you might opt for somewhere between casual and dressy. It doesn't hurt to keep up with the latest fashions. How to use humor appropriately. Inserting a little bit of humor into your presentation can relax an audience, brighten up your speech, and make it more memorable and build confidence. As long as your jokes work, that is. Humor, however, can be a tad bit tricky, so stick to the following suggested guidelines. Number one, unless you're doing a comedy routine, plan to use humor sparingly. Number two, plan your humor ahead of time. Even the best comedians are well prepared. This isn't to say you can't ad-lib on occasion, but don't depend on it. Number three, humor needs to fit the crowd. The slightly tasteless joke you heard at work is probably not the one to tell in front of the PTA or your church group. Also, forget the inside jokes unless you're sure everyone in your audience is an insider. Number four, think of reference points. A joke about a typewriter probably won't work in front of a sixth grade class because they may not even know what a typewriter is. Ask yourself, will they know what I'm talking about? Many speakers have bombed when using the wrong material for a given crowd. Number five, an excellent rule of thumb is that you cannot joke about a minority or ethnic group unless you are part of that group. Even then, make sure you're not stepping over the line of good taste. Number six, if you choose to tell a funny story or anecdote, make sure you clearly set the scene. Don't just assume they know the details and jump to a punchline. Number seven, it helps if you're enjoying the story or the joke you are telling. Smile. Number eight, puns and riddles typically don't ever work. Number nine, try to work humor into your speech so that it flows. Don't blatantly announce an upcoming joke with something like, "And now I'd like to tell a joke." Number 10, focus on humor that people can relate to from everyday occurrences. Number 11, don't be afraid to tell a funny story or joke about yourself. You don't need to be self-deprecating, but it's okay to laugh at yourself. Number 12, if a joke doesn't get a laugh, just keep on going. You can comment on the joke not working, but never get upset with your audience if they didn't laugh at what you thought was a great line. Humor is definitely tricky. It's a fabulous way to break the tension, but you still want to maintain your credibility. Therefore, you have to know when it fits and when it does not belong. Too many speakers have tried to force a joke in when it isn't the right time or place. Sprinkle humor into your presentation like a chef adds seasoning to a dish. Selecting the right word choice. As you prepare your presentation, you need to think very carefully about the words you're going to use. Many people like politicians, news broadcasters, radio personalities have gotten themselves in trouble for failing to select their words carefully. For that reason, they then spend an inordinate amount of time correcting and explaining their previous statements. So then, how do you choose what to say? Use conversational words. Whether you're speaking at a formal or informal gathering, you want to speak naturally. For example, within the past several days, it has come to our understanding that there has been some discourteous conduct displayed by a portion of our student community. Sounds far more awkward than, "We have recently learned that some of our students have been behaving poorly." Consider your audience. Will they understand your choice of words and phrases? An audience of medical practitioners will understand more complex medical terminology than a general audience. Likewise, teens speak their own language. Consider the formality of the gathering. If people are paying $1,000 a plate for a black tie dinner, they're going to expect higher priced words. Try to avoid using slang, dude. Double check and triple check that your wording won't offend anyone. While you can't guarantee that no one is going to be offended by what you say, you can try to be politically correct. Make sure that you are consistent. If you said that you didn't have a relationship with an intern in your opening statement, then don't turn around and say you might have had such a relationship a couple of minutes later. Select words that are inclusive of your audience. Speeches that have too much emphasis on I, me, or my can become quite self-indulgent and alienate your audience. Instead, you might use phrases like, we can all benefit from, or you've probably all seen this type of thing before. Even a rhetorical question such as, how many of us use deodorant every day, can hook the audience. To repeat or not to repeat, it can be awkward if the speaker uses the same word repeatedly for no apparent reason. On the other hand, a catchphrase or buzzword can be effective. You might also repeat a word or phrase for emphasis. For example, we need to get involved in our children's education. We need to get involved in local planning issues. We need to get involved in our neighborhood cleanup. Avoid words you have a hard time pronouncing. Tape yourself. Listen closely. If you find yourself saying axe instead of ask, you need to work on your pronunciation or find another word. Don't use words you don't understand. Using transitions. Have you ever noticed how some speakers are able to move from one subject to another so smoothly that you didn't even notice the transition? On the other hand, you've probably seen speakers who get so lost trying to make a transition that they practically need to send up flares to find the next topic. Making a smooth transition is a key part of public speaking. Smooth does not always mean unnoticed or subtle. If the audience is taking notes or they are there for the purposes of learning or training, you'll want them to pay careful attention to the fact that you are talking about something new. Here are some ideas for making transitions flow smoothly. Use a bridge or connecting word or phrase such as, in addition, meanwhile, or let's also consider. Telegraph points from a list. Our first topic is, the second point we want to discuss is, this is not subtle, but it can be very effective when making a presentation or when teaching. Insert a short phrase. Ask a rhetorical question. Use movement. You might walk out from behind the podium or sit down on the edge of the desk when starting on a new subject. Take a momentary break for questions. Before I continue, does anyone have any questions? Note that asking for questions is effective only if you take a couple of questions and save the rest for the end of the talk. Otherwise, you'll lose your continuity completely. And be careful not to use the same transition repeatedly. Some people use the same words such as anyway, so, or okay, every time they move on to something else. Awkward repetition gives the impression that you didn't plan very carefully. Good posture and a positive personality. The manner in which you are standing can convey your energy level and enthusiasm. Posture and body language is an important part of public speaking. Thus, special attention is needed. Shoulders back, chin up indicates confidence and makes it easier for you to project through deep breaths. Looking down or slouching gives the impression that you really don't believe in what you're saying. Sitting can be tricky. Dangling legs look awkward and a little bit childlike, which is adorable if you are 4 years old, but not if you're 45. If your feet don't reach the floor from a fully seated position, then perch on the front portion of the seat and put 1 foot flat on the floor. In a small, casual gathering, you can sit back a little bit more comfortably, but always remember to sit up straight. Sit well back in the chair with your feet flat on the floor, or if it makes you feel more comfortable and will help you avoid the temptation to tap your toes, cross your legs at the ankles. Don't cross your legs higher up, as it tends to lead to foot wiggling or playing with shoes or socks. Sitting tends to cause people to take more shallow breaths and thus to speak more softly. Keep this in mind and don't let it happen to you. Remember to take in a good amount of air and project yourself. It's okay to rest your hand or arm on a podium, desk, or table, but do it so that you look relaxed and informal while maintaining good posture. Note that leaning does not mean slouching, and don't hang on too tight or your audience will see that you're really nervous. Eye contact. Too often speakers lose their audience because they are not establishing a rapport with them. Making eye contact with your audience will help solve your problem by enhancing the lines of communication, especially as you begin your presentation. It also gets the audience involved and projects confidence and a sense of authority. Conversely, looking away from your audience projects insincerity, and it conveys a sense that you don't really even care if they're listening or not. So don't spend too much time staring at your notes or at the microphone. Practice making eye contact while talking with friends. Be careful, however, not to stare. If you keep your gaze fixed on someone for 20 seconds, that person is really going to become a little bit uncomfortable, and if you stare at someone for 2 minutes straight, he's probably going to get a restraining order against you. To emphasize a point, you may lean toward or even step toward an audience member. Look for a friendly or interested person. Ask them a rhetorical question. Smile. Make them part of your speech. It's very important to note that the larger the audience or the brighter the spotlight, the less likely it is that you will actually be able to make contact with audience members. Nonetheless, you want to look at the people you can see. Choose a friendly-looking person in the middle of the audience, not in the first row. Otherwise, the people in the back rows will be looking at the top of your head. How to effectively use props. Props or visuals of any kind can enhance certain presentations and destroy others. If you are doing a corporate presentation, leading a training session, or conducting a demonstration of some type, props, anything from a flip chart to a prototype of a product, may enhance your speech. In the middle of a commencement speech or at a political rally, on the other hand, a prop might seem awkward. Know the crowd and the occasion. Then make sure that whatever you want the audience to focus attention on is being included for a good reason. If your prop is large, such as a flip chart or chalkboard, position yourself to the side and be careful not to block anyone's view. Face your audience, not your props. Talk to people, not objects. Reveal your visuals only when you're ready to refer to them. Stop talking when you write on a chalkboard or flip chart. When you're done, turn back to the audience and continue speaking. When you're done referring to a visual, turn your flip chart to a blank page to move the attention of the audience back to you while you continue talking. Handheld props can sometimes help you illustrate a point. Use them sparingly and hold them at about chest level. Depending on the room and the equipment provided, have screens or other major props to the side of the stage, not in the middle. This way, you maintain center stage and remain the audience's main focus. Don't forget to breathe. Sometimes a two-second pause while speaking in public will seem to last forever. However, it's worth it if it makes your presentation more effective. Pausing at the right time can provide your audience with a moment to digest the information. This is particularly helpful when teaching or presenting new information. Allow you to catch your breath or to gather your next thought. Allow you to change topics more easily. Help you emphasize a point. Comics typically pause before a punchline momentarily to help emphasize the punchline to follow. Other speakers will pause after a key point in a story and make sure it sinks in. Don't be afraid of the silence. Add some feeling. Very often, it's not what you say but how you say it that makes the difference between a so-so presentation and a great one. Consider the various ways in which you can say the following sentence and the difference in meaning. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. The emphasis means the speaker is going out on a limb to imply that this is his or her personal opinion. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. The emphasis signifies that the speaker isn't certain about the value of the presentation for the group. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. The emphasis states that this specific presentation, as opposed to others, has value. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. The emphasis signifies that there has been some doubt about the value of the presentation. I think this presentation will be valuable to everyone in attendance. The emphasis here implies that some might doubt the value of the presentation to all present. Clearly, emphasis matters. Emphasize not only with your words, but with your expression and gestures. Get moving. Are you too stiff on stage? Is someone from a museum building a glass case around you? If so, then it's time to start moving. Movement helps the audience stay attentive while helping you stay relaxed. After all, your muscles start to tense up if you stand in one position for a long time. If you're limited by a lectern or even a podium, try moving off to the side, if possible, when you're trying to make an important point. Here are some other tips. Always face the audience as you move. Draw your audience in by moving forward. It makes it seem as though you are talking to them more personally. Remember to stay centered when moving around. You don't want to give your presentation to only one side of the room. Don't overdo it. A little bit of movement can enhance a presentation, but pacing back and forth can become distracting. Controlling your hands and arms. Many speakers are more comfortable at a podium or lectern because it blocks their lower body and provides a place to rest their hands. A microphone stand also gives you some place to put your hands, however, it doesn't look natural or relaxed. If you're not comfortable holding the mic, place one hand on or behind the stand to keep yourself centered. Leave the other hand free for gesturing. Hold on gently to prevent feedback. Suggestions for taming your limbs. Hard as it may be to do, keeping your arms loosely at your sides makes it easier to gesture and harder to fidget or distract the audience. Gently holding your hands in front of you at your wrists can be a comfortable alternative, and it will still allow you to make hand gestures as you talk. When you have a wireless microphone or are micless, you still need to figure out what to do with those arms. Putting your hands in your pockets makes you look as though you are nervous or trying to hide something. The hands on the hips posture gives the impression that you are either waiting for someone or that you're annoyed. Keeping your hands behind your back makes it look like you're either hiding something or ice skating. Crossed arms make you look disinterested, and your audience will pick up on it. Wringing your hands will make your audience as nervous as you are. Some speakers hold a drink or another object. However, if you are going to hold something other than a drink or note cards, chances are it's going to draw attention, and you will therefore need to mention it. Arms hanging straight down can cause you to drop your shoulders. Don't forget to lift your arms to gesture. Types of gestures. Descriptive gestures help you clarify your words, help create a visual image, or define a measurement. It wasn't this big in the catalog. Emphatic gestures emphasize a point or a need, such as for unity. To win this election, it's up to you. Suggestive gestures present a thought, idea, or emotion. For example, you can easily convey that you don't know the answer. Prompting gestures are used to get a specific response from the audience. Let's hear it for John Clark. Face it, most of us talk with our hands. Unless you're driving, it really does help the communication process. When speaking in public, gestures should be, or at least appear to be, natural and spontaneous. Gestures should be made with the arms away from the body. Arms held too closely to the body will make you appear uncomfortable or robotic. Be careful not to gesture with the hand holding the microphone, and try to avoid using the same gesture over and over again. Repetition can become monotonous. This is somewhat a catch-22. You want to practice making unrehearsed, natural gestures, which is, of course, a contradiction. Body language. Is your body saying more than your mouth? Have you ever been accused of saying something without even opening your mouth? Sure you have. It happens all the time. From flirtation to fury, body language can speak volumes with the use of any actual words. In fact, studies at the University of California have shown that as much as 55% of a speaker's influence comes from his or her body language. So what exactly is your body saying? If your posture is somewhat slouched and you have your hands in your pocket, you are probably conveying the message, "I really wish this was over." Crossing your arms or putting your hands on your hips could be saying to your audience, "I don't really care what you have to say, but go ahead and ask your stupid question." The more you speak in public and the better prepared you are, the more you will become aware of what your body is saying. If you're sitting in a chair but look as if you're lying on a sofa, your body is saying, "I really don't care about this." If you're sitting straight up in your chair, smiling and making good eye contact, you are letting others know, "I'm interested." When standing straight up with your arms to the side, shoulders back, and smiling, your body is telling others, "I'm confident and ready to tell you something." Dealing with questions. When responding to a question, focus your attention on the person asking the question, but don't exclude the rest of the audience entirely. After you hear the question, look around the room to see if the other audience members took in the question. If there seems to be any doubt, repeat the question. The bigger the room, the more important this is. Typically, you will have control over when questions may be asked. Often, a speaker or presenter will make it clear that they will field all questions at the end. If you've already done that, stick with the game plan. Some suggestions for a Q&A session. Direct the microphone, if you are using one, to the person asking the question, but only if you can get close enough for it to pick up what the person is saying. Prepare in advance for some commonly asked questions on your topic. Call on audience members from different parts of the room. Answer the questions in a concise manner if possible. try to avoid going off on tangents. Set up a stopping point. You can indicate how many more questions you're going to take or state clearly that this is going to have to be the last question. If the person asking the question is right in front of you, you might opt to move a couple of steps away while still maintaining eye contact. This helps eliminate that one-to-one feeling that alienates the rest of the room, and you'll notice that talk show hosts do this. If you are on a panel or there are other speakers, don't feel obligated to answer every question unless it has been directed totally at you. If you know people have different viewpoints that differ from yours, be brave. Let them ask questions. If you're not sure of an answer, let them know that you'll find out the answer later. You might also pose the question to the audience. This is perfectly acceptable, provided you don't do this with every question, which indicates that you were not prepared for a Q&A session to begin with. Introductions. Sometimes if you want something done right, you need to just do it yourself. This is very true when it comes to a proper introduction. From mispronouncing the name of the speaker to neglecting key credentials, introductions have gone awry many times over. Write out your own introduction clearly. Give it to the person introducing you several minutes before you are scheduled to speak. This will afford enough time for the person to read it through a couple of times, but not enough time for him or her to lose the card. What to write? Your introduction should be brief. You don't want an introduction that is longer than the speech. Easy on the ears. Don't try to dazzle them with a title like Resident Co-Executive Associate Director of Therapeutic Linguistic Diagnostic Intervention. Applicable. If you're about to address a Little League team, the fact that you have a master's degree in labor economics and industrial relations is probably not relevant and doesn't need to be mentioned. Current or recent? Unless your claim to fame was childhood stardom, stick with your most recent accomplishments, keeping the audience on their toes. Have you ever been sitting in an audience and noticed that one or two or more people were starting to doze off? Have you ever been one of those people? How do you keep your audience awake? Easy. You dazzle them, include them, surprise them, and keep them on their toes. Besides juggling flaming torches or swallowing knives, you can grab an audience's attention in numerous ways. In a small crowd, you might get audience members involved in the presentation, give away inexpensive but appropriate items that go with your presentation, vary your tone and pitch, even shout at some point if it helps and is appropriate, shift positions or move to a different location if possible, do something unexpected, find a new way to present old material. You should also respond to the needs of your audience. Are they dozing off because it's too hot? Ask someone to open a window. Are they having trouble hearing you? You may need to speak louder or even have the volume on the mic turned up. Perhaps after listening to you discuss new payroll tax accounting methods for more than 2 hours, they need a break. Give them one. And black coffee. Last-minute checklist. Before you arrive at the podium, run through this last-minute checklist and make sure you haven't forgot anything. Check your outfit. Can you move comfortably? Are you having a wardrobe malfunction? Is your zipper down? Make sure you're not wearing any noisy jewelry or other items with which to fidget. Have your flip chart, PowerPoint presentation, chalkboard, and other props all set up and ready to go. Check your hair and teeth. Remember to wear deodorant with antiperspirant. Make sure you have your notes and make sure they're in the proper order. Did you give whoever will introduce you your introduction? Focus on shoulders back, head up, eyes out to the audience. Remember to breathe as you speak. Speak clearly and not too fast. Don't forget that pauses are good things. Allow yourself a moment to relax and gather your thoughts. Think positively. You can do this.